Hello everyone. One of the first things people think about from ancient Greek maths must be Pythagoras' theorem. In fact, we know a version of the result was being used in what's now Iraq over 12 centuries before Pythagoras' lifetime in the 6th century BCE. And we also know that Pythagoras became such a figure of legend soon after his death that we're sceptical of a lot of the stories about him, including the idea that he proved this result, or indeed that he was so delighted with it that he went and sacrificed a cow to the gods. But anyway, I think the name is here to stay. So there are many proofs of the theorem, and in this video I want to show you the one from Euclid's Elements, so from maybe 300 BC or just a little bit later. And there, the theorem forms the climax to book one. Before we start, I just want to mention a familiar fact that we're going to use, but maybe not in the most familiar way. And that's that the area of a triangle is half its base times its height. When people first hear this, the triangle tends to be drawn with the base horizontal at the bottom and the height going up vertically. So in other words, base and height have their ordinary non-mathematical meanings. But of course, it doesn't matter which angle you're looking at the triangle from. So for us, a particularly helpful way of thinking about this result is going to be, you pick any of the sides as the base, go to the other vertex and draw a line through it parallel to your base, and the perpendicular distance between the two parallel lines gives you your height. So watch out for that shortly. Now let's get into the theorem, which tells us that when we have a right angle triangle, the squares of the sides around the right angle add up to the square of the hypotenuse, the side opposite the right angle. When Pythagoras and Euclid talked about the square of a side length, they weren't so much thinking numerically, like saying this side is 2 and 2 times 2 is 4. As they were thinking geometrically, we build squares on each side and then look at how their areas are related. So we need to show that the areas of these two squares add up to the area of the big one. And Euclid makes this sum really clear because he shows that if we drop the perpendicular from the right angle A to the hypotenuse and across to the far edge of the square, this left-hand square has the same area as the left-hand rectangle that we've just created, and the right-hand square is similarly the same area as the right-hand rectangle. So how do we prove that? Well, there's a very fast way using similar triangles, which I just leave as a little challenge for you to think about if you want to. But Euclid hasn't actually introduced the concept of similar triangles in book one of the Elements. It's actually book six of the Elements that's all about similarity. So we have to make do without them. And basically what we're going to do is draw some lines in the diagram that help us spot some congruent triangles, and that's going to help us compare the areas of these shapes. So first we draw in this line CD and we ask, what's the area of the purple triangle? Now if we take BD as the base, the parallel line through the other vertex is CA and its extension, and so the height of the triangle, the perpendicular distance from BD to CA, is just BA because we know that this is at right angles to BD. So we've got half the base times the height being half of BD times BA, in other words, half the area of this square. And now we draw in the second line here and compare the red triangle ABE to the purple one. Because we're dealing with squares, we have BD being the same length as BA, BC being the same length as BE, and the angles at B in both of these triangles are a right angle plus angle ABC. So the two triangles are therefore congruent. In modern terms, the red triangle is just the purple one rotated around point B by 90 degrees. And what about the area of this red triangle? Well, take BE as its base, the line through A parallel to BE is this one, and so the height of the triangle relative to BE is BG. In other words, the red triangle is half of this rectangle. The purple triangle we got was half of this square, and the red triangle and the purple triangle have the same area because they're congruent. So we get that the square and the rectangle have the same area. Of course, there's nothing special about using the squares on the left as opposed to the square and the rectangle on the right. The equivalent line of reasoning can be applied to that second square and we'd get our result. So I'm going to leave you with just a couple more challenges to think about before I finish the video. So the first one is that in this diagram, it looks as if we've got three lines all meeting here at a single point. So can you prove that? And this is actually the problem that Heron of Alexandria addresses in his commentary on this problem in Euclid. You may have come across Heron, who lived in the 1st century CE, for preserving a beautiful formula about how to get the area of a triangle just in terms of its side lengths. Anyway, I'll do a follow-up video on how he proved that these three lines do coincide, because it's a great proof, I think, for understanding how the ancient geometers like to think. Going back to Euclid, he goes on to show that if you have a triangle with the squares of two sides equaling the square on the third side, it must have a right angle opposite the third side. So in other words, Pythagoras' theorem is only true of right-angled triangles. And Euclid argues as follows. If you've got such a triangle, sum of the two squares is equal to the third square, construct a right-angled triangle on one of the short sides, so for example on AC, construct it with AX being equal to AB and a right angle at A. Then we have that AXC and ABC are congruent. They share the side AC. We've just said by design that AX is equal to AB. And more or less we know that XC is equal to BC because we were told that AB squared plus AC squared equals BC squared. And we've got Pythagoras' theorem to tell us that AB squared plus AC squared equals XC squared because it's right angled. But if the triangles are congruent, then they must both be right angled. Well, that's a neat way of proving the converse of Pythagoras' theorem. Another way is to say that if we've got an angle at A that's not a right angle, then the first argument that we looked at would show us that the two squares don't add up to the square on the hypotenuse. For example, in this diagram, A has become acute, and using our congruent triangles again, we see that the small squares are each larger than the corresponding rectangle, and if A were obtuse, they would be smaller. So this leads into my final thing for you to go away and think about if you'd like to, which is, if you know the cosine rule, how would you be able to illustrate it using this diagram? Well, let me just finish off by saying that Euclid certainly isn't the simplest proof of Pythagoras' theorem. But for me, there's something very appealing about how just adding a couple of lines to the diagram makes you see some congruent triangles that help you map those smaller squares very neatly onto two rectangles that make up the larger square. And in my experience, once you've seen this proof, it really sticks in the memory. The diagram for it became quite iconic. You can see it here on a modern statue of Euclid from Oxford. And in this 12th century manuscript, we see that the theorem had even acquired its own nickname, Heronymphe, which might mean the bride, and has led to the modern name, the bride's chair, for the diagram. Well, I hope you've also been impressed with Euclid's proof. If you've enjoyed the video, do share it around and consider subscribing to the channel to hear about future videos about ancient Greek mathematics, including the follow-up video to this one, which is going to be about that problem from Heron. And thank you very much for watching.